Docker is made up of two main components. First of all, you have a Docker CLI, which is a command line utility that you would use to build and run containers. For example, to build a Docker image, you would create a Docker file and define steps. You may need to add libraries, compile your source code into the final executable, and perhaps define some configurations. The next step would be to run Docker build. As a result, you get a Docker image. In order to store and distribute that image, we use Docker registries. It's usually a remote service where you can upload your image and sometimes run some security tests and validations. To upload the local image, we use Docker push command. Now, the second part of Docker is the Docker daemon. Sometimes this is called a client-server architecture. Dockerd is a container runtime. It listens to requests from Docker client and manages objects such as images, containers, networks, and volumes. For example, if you want to run your Docker image, you would use Docker run command. This will pull Docker image from the registry and start the container. Just to clarify, the Docker image is the read-only template that Docker uses to run the container, and a container itself is a runnable instance of that image. Now, what if you have multiple applications and you need to manage them at scale? At this point, you would need to manage your Docker containers on multiple servers. To solve this problem, in the early days, Docker created something called Docker Swarm, which is a container orchestration tool. It was a great solution that abstracted away a lot of complexity of running containers at scale and was great for simple workloads, especially if you're building on-premise. However, this high-level abstractions also made it difficult to extend and adapt to your needs. Kubernetes took a different approach. It provides low-level constructs to the point where you can even extend the API using RADs. So, what is Kubernetes? Well, it's also a container orchestration platform that allows you to run containers at scale. Kubernetes consists of the control plane, which also includes the etcd database, where Kubernetes stores all the cluster configuration, such as how many containers and where need to be running. Besides the control plane, you have worker nodes where Kubernetes actually runs those containers. During the early stages of development, Kubernetes used Docker as a container runtime. So you can think of Kubernetes as another client of your Docker. For example, to run application on Kubernetes, typically you would build Docker image, then upload that image to remote repository. Then you would create one of many Kubernetes deployment objects. The simplest one used in production is a deployment, which is perfect for stateless applications. Then you would define how many replicas you want to run, define how much resources you want to allocate to each instance of your application, and optionally configure health checks that Kubernetes can use to monitor your application. To run your application, you would use the kubectl client and apply YAML configuration. Then Kubernetes will select appropriate nodes and run your application. If one of your application instances fail, Kubernetes will reschedule it on another node. The same applies to infrastructure. If a Kubernetes node fails, Kubernetes will reschedule your application to ensure the necessary number of replicas are running at any given time. Instead of manually scaling your application up and down, you can also define auto-scaling policies, and so on. I have another detailed video explaining Kubernetes architecture and the scheduling process if you're interested. Kubernetes also allows you to run stateful applications. For example, if you have a database, Kubernetes will allocate a volume and attach that volume to the node where database is running. Now, if your database gets rescheduled to another node, Kubernetes will also detach and reattach the volume so that you don't lose your data. Kubernetes uses declarative approach for managing containers, which means you define the desired state, and Kubernetes uses its controllers to update the current state. This functionality is not only used internally to manage containers, but also by some open source projects to manage external resources. For example, Crossplane is alternative to Terraform that uses YAML to create infrastructure. The biggest difference is that Terraform only detects drift when you run it, but Crossplane continuously monitors the current and desired state. For instance, if you manually update something from the UI console, Crossplane will detect it in about 5 minutes and fix the drift. Now, Kubernetes used Docker as a container runtime for a very long time. However, Docker has way more functionality that Kubernetes needs. Docker is a great tool, but was initially created for humans to interact with containers. Kubernetes used something called Docker Shim to properly integrate Docker runtime into Kubernetes. Docker isn't actually one thing, it's entire tech stack. And one part of it is thing called Containerd, which is a high-level container runtime by itself. In the recent versions, Kubernetes deprecated Docker Shim and its use of Docker as a container runtime in Kubernetes in favor of runtimes that use container runtime interface created for Kubernetes. Now, to be clear, the most popular container runtime right now is Containerd, which was originally developed by Docker and is still used by Docker itself to run containers. It's a smaller and more efficient executable that runs containers on the host. It uses fewer resources and allows you to run more containers more efficiently. So you would use Docker for local development, building and distributing Docker images, and you would use Kubernetes to run your Docker images at scale.